Hey, Sarah, are we live? Hallelujah. Welcome, everybody. So, for all of you that weren't here yesterday, you missed it. We were blessed yesterday. So thank you, everybody, for sharing stories about our time together here. It was amazing to hear stories from your perspective. And I was pretty happy. I only used half a box of Kleenex yesterday. I thought that was pretty good. Yeah, mixed. I had talked to our son in Arizona just before we came. And he says to me, yeah, I know that that's going to be kind of a mixed set of emotions. We're excited about what God's doing, but at the same time, I look at each and every one of your faces, and I'm taking a treasure with me to Alberta, a treasure of memories that each and every one of you have deposited into my life. So thank you all. All right. Do we have any major announcements? I think we're kind of on autopilot right now, but I always got to check with the boss to make sure. Coffee. Yes, thank you. I said to her, I said, yeah, you need to give me a very loud and signal or something. After church, we are going to attempt to finish the rest of the cake that we started yesterday. So come on down and have some cake with us, tell some stories, and enjoy a coffee and fellowship downstairs right after service. We want to thank everybody that's here and everybody that's online. It never ceases to amaze me. Yesterday, there was a young man here who has ever attended the church here, but our pastor had a major influence in his life when he was in grade 2. She was a teacher's aide, and she had quite interesting stories to share about him. And he came out yesterday, and it was kind of, he was kind of symbolic of the 40-plus years that our pastor has inputted into this community. And so it was amazing. It was great to have him here. And he says, I just want you to know something. Even though I don't come to the church, I do watch online. So you are all part of inputting into people's lives online. So keep on keeping on. You guys are amazing. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just love you and appreciate you. We just thank you that you are such a good, good Father. And I sincerely pray, Father, that each and every person that is here today or watching online will not leave the same way they came. Father, you have a plan for each and every one of us. Even before we were in our mother's womb, you had a plan for us, a plan to prosper, a plan to have an impact wherever we're planted. Father God, I just thank you that the Holy Spirit's in the house today, and he's here to set captives free, to break chains off of people's lives, that we may all be a more accurate reflection of you, our Heavenly Daddy, that we have your DNA in us. Therefore, we should have the same characteristics and attributes as you. The world should look upon us and go, hey, I don't know what it is about them, but I want, what they have. So, Father, we thank you for the worship service today. We thank you for the message that you've put into Pastor Cindy's heart. Give her the ability to share what you have for this congregation. And Holy Spirit, we give you liberty to interpret that word so that it's an individual message for each and every one of your kids. We pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen. Let's stand together. Giving this morning. How many of you know that scripture is full of references of God's people entering into his temple, into his house, into his presence, bearing gifts? Amen. Bearing gifts for him because he is a gift giver. How many of you like to get gifts? Anybody here? Amen. Well, we serve a Father who is the most amazing gift giver, and we're going to be talking about that today and for a while to come. Thank you, Father. You may be seated as we receive this morning's offerings. Thank you. here this morning has an impact globally. Amen. It's not just for us in these four walls. Amen. We serve a mighty God, and all over this world, His Spirit is moving. He is showing His glory all over this world. Recently, we've had an opportunity to partner, to be a blessing to the country of Ukraine, amen, through the Gospel Music Festival. I don't know what the final count is, but I know that I believe there was over $7,000 that was raised. That deserves a hallelujah, amen. When the many are one, nothing is impossible to us, especially if God is in the midst of what is going on, amen. So, Father, this morning, we just lift up this service to you. We thank you, Lord God, that we're not just getting here, Lord God, to fill a time slot on a Sunday morning, but we believe, God, that you are here by your Holy Spirit, that you love us so much. But, Lord, you love this whole world. You love this whole world so much that you gave your one and only Son, Jesus, so that anyone who believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life, Lord. So, Father, we come into agreement with your word. Jesus, you said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We lift up, Lord God, our brothers and sisters around the world, because we recognize, God, that we are one body. And when one part of the body hurts, Lord, we're all impacted. Father, when one part of the body rejoices, we all rejoice in that strengthening, in that blessing, Lord. So, Father, all over this city, your sons and daughters are gathering in your name, and we pray, Father, a blessing and an anointing on the word of God as it goes forth. Sweet fellowship of your Holy Spirit. And that, Father, you would continue to draw sons and daughters to yourself. In Jesus' name, and the church said, amen, amen. Would you greet someone as you're seated?
Good morning, everyone. Woohoo! As Mark said, we just want to extend thanks to you, our church body, for the wonderful community open house that you hosted. And some of you were doing heavy lifting behind the scenes. I know I got an email from Sandy that said, or a text that said, the fellowship hall is off limits to you and the pastor. We've got it all decorated up there. You're not allowed down there. Well, you know what, Sandy? I want to thank you because you saved me from at least two or three stale muffins that I probably otherwise would have went down into the kitchen and helped myself to. Anyway, we had a wonderful time. There was just a sweet sense of God's spirit there. And as Mark said, one of my former students showed up, and that was just very, very sweet. You guys gave us a beautifully commissioned painting by Barbara Legg of Millennium Park. And, you know, paintings take a while to grow on you, to take in all that's there. And as I was looking at it again this morning, I just noticed the detail that she put into the mountains. And these mountains are not my mom's favorite thing. They were my dad's favorite thing. That's why we're here. But every time I would go away and come in, whether we were driving down the Bombay, sometimes coming from from the west down from Grand Forks or flying in, the one thing I always recognized my mountains. And, you know, it just has a place in my heart. And so thank you for that beautiful painting. I will bring that some Sunday and show everyone what you gifted us with memories from here. And also the stories that people shared were just priceless and precious. And I think there were some folks here that don't necessarily attend our church, aren't necessarily believers in Jesus yet, or they're working their way up to that, who were really deeply touched by the testimonies that you shared of how your life has been impacted first and foremost by the Lord, but as he has expressed his love through this congregation. Amen. Last week, if you were here, you will know that we had baptism service, and we had three people who were baptized, one of whom is here. And Tamane, will you come on up? This is your baptismal certificate. We just love you, and we celebrate what God's doing in your life. Mm. Anything you want to say?
I'm so glad I got the opportunity to be baptized, and this church is really being a blessing to my life and my spiritual life also.
Thank you so much. We love you.
I love you so much, and I love Father Mark too.
Amen, amen, amen. And we will get Randy and Carol when they are here at the next appointed time. Well, if you have your Bibles, we're going to turn initially to Psalm 139. Some of you have your Bibles on your little devices. How many of you know your pastor loves the Word of God?
Yes.
Amen? It is the power of the gospel to set us free. I am not ashamed of the gospel. For it is the power unto salvation. And that salvation is not just a ticket to heaven. How many of you know that? That God's salvation is so dense, it is so thick, it is so wide, it is so high. It encompasses every single aspect of being human and of doing life and being part of him. It is so multifaceted, we can never exhaust the riches of God's word. Psalm 139, verses 13 through 16. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. Let's just repeat that. I praise you. I praise you. Because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You didn't just climb up out of some slime out of the millennium ponds. You were made. Your works, who are we talking to? God. Your works are wonderful. Look at your neighbor and tell them, you're wonderful. Amen. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. How many of you know God don't make no junk? That's the only time you can use a double negative when you're getting down with the hood language. God don't make no junk. It's a little praise song from one of the churches that I served in down south. I know that full well. David is saying, I know. God, you do everything well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. I received an email from the president of our local pro-life society. And she was heartbroken because some of the billboards saying, just simply, choose life, beautiful picture of a baby, have been defaced, have been vandalized. A big one in Grand Forks, had choice spray painted over it. Big, huge, beautiful billboard. You know, and they've made the decision to leave that graffiti on there because it speaks almost more loudly about the hearts of the people who put it there and the state of our world than the original billboard. God's word is the final word. And God's word says that you were known, that God had a plan for your life before even one of your days came into being. God's word says that you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Now, I want you to hear your pastor clearly. Sin is devastating, and many women have been left in compromised positions, have been abandoned, have been brutalized, and have felt like they had no other recourse, no other help, apart from ending the life of their unborn child. Make no mistake about this. There is never any condemnation in this house. No condemnation coming from this pastor. Because I have not walked in those steps. But I want you to know, if that's you today, that God has healing for you, that he has forgiveness for you. And abortion is not the unpardonable sin. The only sin that can never be pardoned is the sin of rejecting God to the very end of your life. Are we clear on that in this house? Can I hear a loud amen?
Amen.
Amen. We are fearfully and wonderfully made. We're starting into this last push before we leave. September 29th is our moving day. So September 25th will be the last day that I'm officially in this pulpit as your senior pastor. And Lord willing, Pastor Junior Spooner will be here in the pulpit on the 1st. And I'm going to be chiming in online, checking up on y'all. So no skipping out. Yeah, I'm going to be checking up on you. But as I've said before, I feel like there's this urgency getting ready for this transition. If you're thinking about dropping out or you're going, Pastor Cindy and Mark are leaving, might as well just write it off. There's not going to be much excitement going on at church. Wrong, 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 and wrong again. Because God has spoken a clear word to me about getting us up to racing, running speed. Amen? When Pastor Spooner comes, he's going to find a congregation who are full of the love of God, full of the Spirit of God, and ready to embrace the vision and go with it.
Amen.
And go with it. So we're starting, it's the same Spirit-filled life, but this next little series, if you want to call it, mini-series called Gifted and Called. You are gifted and called. I want to talk a little bit about gifts and differences. How many of you like getting gifts? Anybody here not like getting gifts? Let me just, no hands up. Okay. We all like getting gifts. Okay. How many of you like giving gifts? All right. That's most of us. Because, and the Bible says that there's a blessing. It's more blessed to give than it is to receive. You know, some of you may notice that I'm wearing a new outfit today. I just got this thing going on. The whole ensemble was a gift from my sweet sister Maria, who loves to give gifts. And it's been hanging in the closet for a while, not because it wasn't a beautiful gift, but because the pastor felt a little fluffy for it. And since I have lost and found the same 5 pounds, 5 times since you gave it to me, I decided, let's just go for it. Live on the wild side. Some of you love, absolutely love to give gifts. And God is the greatest gift giver that there is. We're going to be talking about spiritual gifts over the next 3, 4, maybe even 5 weeks. We've touched on it before, and I want you to make sure you don't miss a Sunday. If you got to be away, watch the live stream or the recording, because these messages are going to build on each other. And we're really going to dig into what are the spiritual gifts. Some of us know about spiritual gifts, and for others, it's a new topic. There's a lot of things that impact our giftedness, where we're born, our family of origin, our DNA. How many of you are gifted like maybe your parents? You have some of the giftings your parents had? And maybe as you get older, you're going, oh my goodness, I'm turning into my mother or my father. Right? Yes, amen. I see that hand. There's stuff that we just can't get away from that's a part of us. Well, is there a family photo there, Sarah? Can you pull that up? Yeah, that was taken over in Utashenya on our property back in the 1970s, shortly after we moved here. And you can see, this was a Sunday after church, and it was one of the rare family photos. Now, what do you notice about this photo right off the hop, besides big hair? Bright colored jacket. Anybody do matchy-matchy? My mom, and we've got other pictures, you know the Fentex? Crocheted, and I tell you, we had it all hooked up. But my mom would make sure we all matched. Do you notice that everybody matches? All right? So that was Sundays for us, the clothes laid out. And aesthetics are important to our family. My dad is an artist. He is a house painter. Artistry runs in our blood. And you know what? Artistry runs in some of your blood. This beautiful floral arrangement down here on the table was made by Gloria and Francis. Beautiful, beautiful. Some people can just see and bring it together and imagine, right? So one of the things we're going to learn about is that the gifts refract differently through each and every one of us. You can have two, you can have five people that have a similar gifting, but it's going to look a little bit different in everybody. So, for example, organizational skills. I consider myself pretty organized. I have a junk drawer, but, you know, there's designated mess, chaos spots in our house, right? When I met my husband, Mark, I was amazed to find that he liked things nice and neat like I did. And the first time I visited his little bachelor pad, ladies, his spices, which were not a few, were alphabetized. Uh-huh. Alphabetized. Yeah, chives next to cumin next to coriander. And you know what? That DNA, I think it's in the family, because my lovely sister-in-law, Isabel, did me a favor and organized my books, my library. And they have been moved so many times because we've had people coming and going out of, they were just chaos. Well, let me tell you, they are alphabetized. They're alphabetized. Now, when I want to find books on prayer, I may have to search from A to Z to find them all. But they're there, amen? So there are things that are their DNA, they're just in us. This man likes to count beans. He likes to do numbers. You know your pastor does not like math. Flunked it over and over again. I had to take it over and over again in school, in high school. But this guy can do math in his head. And he likes to do math. Like when we're on a trip to Alberta, we've got to take a few extra moments at the gas station while he takes the receipt and figures out the gas mileage. Not once, but every time. And now, church, there has appeared in my new car
a little tiny book in which I am to record every time I get gas, mileage, date, if there was oil put in, because he likes to be organized. He's got an administrative mind. Now, that gift of administration and organization plays out a little differently in pastor. I like organization, but I like it in stuff. For example, my linen closet. I iron just about everything, except fluffy towels. I like the smell of the lavender water on it. I like to see them all neatly folded up like little soldiers in there. It takes me back to my grandma's linen closet. To just have company and be able to grab something and just go and do what you need to do. That is not his gifting. Just like math is not my gifting. There's a difference between functional and purdy or aesthetics. We've got one more picture, and we're going to talk about pet peeves here in a minute, because how you are gifted, especially your strong gifting, is something people are going to notice about you right away. Those of you who are married or have boyfriends and girlfriends, you know that thing that drew you to that person? Probably guaranteed. It's going to maybe be a bit of a pet peeve down the road when the gloss wears off and you go, oh, that thing I thought I could live with, it really sticks. It's actually really a part of him or her, right? So do we have that next picture, Sarah, of the fence? The fence in the house that we rent needs some love. Anybody want to come do painting, just talk to Pastor. The fence, I was blowing. It really needs some help. I was using the leaf blower, and it blew like five of those boards out of the fence. So there was this gaping hole between our yard and our next door neighbor's yard, who were just getting to know, lovely people. And I mentioned to my husband, I came clean, I broke the fence, could you fix it? Now, my husband is a Red Seal carpenter, Finnish carpenter, mind you. So I didn't think that would be a big task, actually. Just, babe, can you handle it? Handle it, Roy. The hole was there, I don't know, 4 or 5 weeks?
Maybe 6.
You know, sometimes one gift gives rise to another gift. When my gift of the stating of the obvious did not generate the action that was required and anticipated, another gift arose in me. Ladies, it's the gift of exhortation, also known as the gift of nagging. Husbands. The gift of nagging. What will the neighbors say? Can you fix it? So I did ask several times, and finally, it was fixed. Apparently the, what is it, a bandsaw?
I don't want to talk about it.
One of his tools is at the brother-in-law's house. And so the fence got fixed, mind you. This was taken this morning. It got fixed, sort of. Now, with my gift of I like it purdy, I like it finished. I like it finished right. And his gift of, it's good enough. Let's get her done and let's move on. There was a little bit of
a gap.
Now, I did let him know I was going to share this. So I asked him, because in our house, it's got to be fair. And we are going to get to scripture, in case you're wondering. But it's going to be real today. Because you know what? In the body, doing life together sometimes is uncomfortable. We rub each other the wrong way. We step on each other's toes. One person's expectation is not another person's expectation. So I asked him, can you tell me, because I may have a blind spot. I don't know what all of my pet peeves are for you. Can you tell me? So he wrote me an email, actually, this morning. God bless him.
Hello, my love. Hello, my love. I just want to go on the record that anything I say or share in this email cannot, capitalized, be used against me in a court of law or in the bedroom. Exclamation mark. My one pet peeve. Only one. You always want to lead. Whether we are hiking, biking, cooking, driving, planning, your ideas are always superior. If for some reason we don't go with your lead, the temperature gets frosty. Cheaper. Especially during any subsequent adult time. Remember, you asked, 7! Much love, your friend for life, Mark. I told him I was going to share. Can we laugh a little bit in the house of God?
Yes.
Can we laugh at our own foibles that we can't see for love or money in ourselves? The thing that you enjoy and love about somebody from the get-go, oh, that girl knows how to get after it. She knows what she wants out of life. Huh. Knows how to use a weed whacker, hallelujah. Got the gift of want it purdy. That can become an Achilles heel, amen? We have to learn, first of all, what our giftings are and what the dark side of our giftings are. And this is true in the body of Christ. It is true when it comes to spiritual gifts. You see, I am my daddy's daughter. My daddy was the original MacGyver. My dad made a clutch out of the heel of a rubber boot that he found in our old Dukobor house on the property for the lawnmower, a clutch for the lawnmower. You give my dad something that's broken, fix, fix, fix. This man does not like to fix, fix, fix. Give him a recipe, give him a blueprint. He will build you the Taj Mahal from scratch. Puff pastry, French puff pastry, no problem. Give him a recipe. He will build it. His gifting is not fixing. His gifting is building. Me, on the other hand, I can see what needs to be fixed, and I get after it. But can you see how those gifts might just kind of clash once in a while? Because people who are leaders need some of those skills. You need to be able to immediately see and assess. But you also need to know when you're working as a team or as a partnership that sometimes you need to just, whoa, Bessie, and let someone else lead. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I just thank you for your word. I thank you for this company of people, Lord God, that we are gifted and we're called by you, and that, Lord, you don't make any junk, that each and every one of us is so precious to you and cherished by you. And God, I pray an anointing upon us right now to receive that which you want to impart to us, the encouragement that you want to give us, Lord God, because different is just different. It doesn't mean it's bad or it's weird. It's needed because, God, you have made us all. We are in your image, and we're called to live out your nature and your character. So bless us, Lord, as we look to your word this morning. All God's people said, amen. Amen. Romans 12, 1 through 8. This morning is just an introduction. I want you to be thinking and chewing on these things, and write down these scripture references. There's only like 3 or 4 of them that we're going to look at, chapters. I want you to read them this week and chew on them and see what the Holy Spirit's going to say to you. Romans 12, 1 through 8. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. What's our true and proper worship? Showing up on Sunday and warming a pew, a seat somewhere? It's offering our whole entire being to the Creator of the universe, who is our Father. Do not conform to the pattern of this world. Would you agree that there's some patterns out in our world? Try putting on Netflix or Disney or anything. Do you see a pattern repeating itself? Are there molds out there that our society and culture is trying to press and constrain, push us and particularly our young children into? You better believe it. You better believe it. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How many of you know that this is control central right here? If the devil can control this, he can control this. Conversely, if the Holy Spirit is the boss of our minds, and our minds have been transformed by God's word, then he is the one who's living, moving, and having his being through us. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, what's Paul saying? I didn't get here on my own. Even this grace is given to us. By the grace given to me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. Wow, there's a lot in that little sentence, isn't there? We're not to think of ourselves above and beyond, but conversely, we're not to put ourselves down and belittle what God has made and called forth in us. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. He has plans and purposes for you that he had before you even took one little breath. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ, we, though many, form one body. Do you know we are one body? But we're not just one body here. We're one body with every Christian, every believer in Jesus in this community. But not just in this community, not just in this nation. We are one body with every believer around the world. So that means when our brothers and sisters in Ukraine are suffering, or in Saudi Arabia, or Africa, or wherever it is, there is an aspect of what they're experiencing that impacts us. And conversely, when we've been blessed not so that we can just kind of sit there and go, no, we've been blessed so that we can be a blessing to the body. Amen? These members do not all have the same function. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. I want you to look at somebody and tell them, you belong to me. You belong to me. And I belong to you. And I belong to you. We have different gifts. Can we say different gifts? According to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. Does everybody have the same amount of faith? No. But to each person, a measure of faith has been given by who? By God. You don't think you have faith? If you're a believer in Jesus, if you've given your life to him, if he's the Lord of your life, you have been given a measure of faith. But how many of you know you don't get, what's that called, the washboard abs by sitting in the recliner and watching Netflix all day? You got to work it, work it, work it, right? That is how your body muscles grow. That is how your spiritual gifts grow, is as you take the little that has been imparted to you and you start to work it. That's how it grows. If it is serving, then serve. Anybody like to serve? I know. There's several of you who are amazing, servant-hearted lovers of Jesus. And this body is so blessed that you are here. If it is teaching, then teach. Anybody teach? Any teachers here? Here's something I want to tell you. Just because you didn't go to teacher school, college, or university doesn't mean you're a teacher. Or that you're not a teacher. My mama, who you know is servant-hearted, taught me to drive. And she taught a number of widowed ladies, older, senior ladies in the church, how to drive. I remember coming up by Trolex there, coming up the hill, in the passing lane, going past a transport, as I'm learning to drive, and there's oncoming traffic. And I start sweating bullets, and my mom's sitting in the seat beside me, cool as a cucumber. Hold that steering wheel straight. I mean, I was just like, I was nervous. I was scared. And she sat there like a statue. Just hold it straight. Just hold it firm. You can do this. Land sakes, as my grandma would say, I certainly could not do that job. And kids, to me, Father is a wonderful driving instructor, but you're never going to have me sitting in the teacher's seat when it comes to driving, because I get nervous even when the instructor is driving sometimes in the winter on icy roads. Can you slow down? It's that leading thing. It's that comfort thing, right? So my mom is a teacher, even though she would never get up here. She tells me that she was asked to preach one time for youth group. The sermon lasted 5 minutes. Different giftings, but still teaching. Amen? If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. Any of you like to write cards to people and, you know, or give a phone call? Say a nice word, show up with cookies, that gift of encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. How many of you like to give? I see one person whose hand is not up, and I tell you, he's one of the most generous givers that I know. Extravagant, extravagant in his giving. How do you know if you've got the gift of giving? You don't complain about it after. You rarely tell people about your giving. The right hand doesn't know what the left hand is doing. You just do it, and it brings you joy. It brings you joy. We're going to dig into all of these a little bit deeper as we move along in the next few weeks. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Nobody likes to be helped and then to hear back from, you know, other sources that they got gossiped about because they needed help in a certain way. That's not the gift of mercy. It might be the gift of Phariseeism, you know, look at what I'm doing over here. Oh, was it tough? Mercy just gives because that is who mercy is. We all have different gifts. It's important to remember that different does not mean bad or weird. I don't know about you guys, but growing up in a family, if we encountered people that weren't like our people, like our family, we're just like, oh, those people are kind of weird. You know, it wasn't until I got older I realized God has made us all differently. We don't all, you know, walk to the beat of the same drum. Different is not necessarily bad. It is God's plan. 1 Corinthians 12, 1 through 31. And this is a longer one. But I want you just to let this wash over you. Now, about the gifts of the Spirit, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed.
It's okay. I love you and I forgive you.
You know that when you were pagans, somehow or other you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I want you to know that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus be cursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in everyone, it is the same God at work. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. We're not talking about that little bit of faith that everybody gets. We're talking about extraordinary faith. And to another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. How many of you know that there are many spirits in the world? There is an unseen realm. There's a Holy Spirit, but there are also evil, demonic, dark powers and spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. This is different languages, missionaries that go to somewhere, and all of a sudden they're speaking a language they've never learned. But there also is a heavenly language of the Holy Spirit. And still to another, the interpretation of tongues. All of these are the work of the one and same Spirit. And he distributes them to each one just as I determine, as he determines. Just as a body, though one has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, free or slave, and we were all given one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If you're here and you are a part of this body, God wanted you here. If they were all one part, where would the body be? Nowhere. As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty. While our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it. So there should be no division in the body, but that its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices. Now you are the body of Christ. And each one of you is a part of it. And God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, and of different kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have the gift of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? Now eagerly desire the greater gifts. And he goes on to talk about love, doesn't he? In chapter 13. This is the most excellent way. Just as love is the foundation of all of the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, patience, long-suffering, so love is the motivation behind every single spiritual gift. It's because God loves us, but he loves the world. And he has chosen to constrain himself to work through his body. We are his hands, we are his feet, we are his mouthpiece. Isn't it amazing that the God who spoke the universes into being constrains himself to work through the church who is his body, his family who is his body? Lastly, and this one I'm saving for last because we get it wrong. We put this one first and we forget about the rest. Ephesians 4, 11 through 16, as we get ready to go to some worship and then communion. So Christ himself gave the apostles. Who are the apostles? Apostles were the original disciples, weren't they? They're the ones who talked with Jesus for 3 years. They saw everything that he had done. They were commissioned by him. But they were also subsequent apostles. And subsequent apostles were not just men, but as we look into the original languages, we see that there were even women who were sent, were empowered. In fact, the word apostle means sent one. Mary Magdalene, out of whom 7 demons had been cast, was the first, if you will. Go and tell my brothers I've risen. Ladies, aren't you glad we're not second-class citizens in the family of God and in the body of God? We are equally gifted and called. It was Christ who gave the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers. It's often called the fivefold ministry. Why? Why? So that they could do all the work? No. To equip his people for works of service. To equip his people. So that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become in every aspect, in every respect, the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work. I don't know about you, church, but I'm really excited about these last few weeks and this word that God has given me to challenge us with, to equip us with. It is the last sermon series, if you will, that I'm preaching in this church, but it will be one of the first that I preach in the one that God is calling us to after we have had a time to heal the heart of the church. It's important. At the Gospel Music Festival, a teacher that I had taught with, Ken DeWitt from Gateway, came up and he said, "Oh my goodness, I didn't know you could sing so well. I'm so embarrassed because when we were teaching grade 2 together, I actually sang in front of you." I said, "Well, Ken, here's the reality. I didn't sing that good back then." There's been a lot of years of practice, of having to just step out and go for it. But I also want to share one other thing. I sang at the Gospel Music Festival like I've never sung before, because singing performance-wise is a little bit different than singing congregationally. But I had a master musician, Gilles Parenteau. He's an amazing, amazing musician, who said, "You can do this." It started out, this is how it started out. "I want you to sing with someone who's going to headline from Vancouver. A gospel diva. You can do it." "Oh, I can be a doo-wop girl. I can do it. I can sing backup for somebody." And when her vacation plans didn't jive with the date for the music festival, all of a sudden we had to go back to the drawing board. And Jules and John came back to me and said, "You can do it." I'm like, "Me? You can do it." I said, "Well, can I bring a friend? Yana?" And we did it together. When someone believes in you, when they speak a word of encouragement over you, when they have eyes to see the gifting in you that you may not have, the eyes to perceive yourself, it's a beautiful gift. I tell Gilles, he called it out of me. "You told me I could do it, and I did everything in my power." Now, did I just waltz up there one day and la, 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 la? No, I tell you, I practiced for hours and hours and hours, and my voice was cracking, and we had to take the key down because it's too high. But when someone who knows something tells you, "You can do this," and you know that God has brought things together, that he has arranged things, and he is positioning you for such a time as this, you have a choice, church. You can be a doubting Thomas. You can be a Moses, pick somebody else. I have stammering lips. Or you can say, "By the grace of God, I will do this. Because not by my power, not by my might, but by the Spirit of Almighty God." Amen? Amen. When you come under the Master's hand, there is nothing that is impossible to you. And church, we have to stop thinking small, because we serve an awesome God who has no small plans for you, no small plans for this church, no small plans for his church globally. His plan is that the glory of the risen King, of the Spirit of God, is going to invade this earth, that every place we put our feet, there comes Christ, there comes the power of the Holy Spirit to convict of sin, yes, but to convict of righteousness and holiness and judgment, and to see the life of God come where there is death, where there is decay, where there is addiction, where there is confusion, where there is bondage. Spirit of the living God comes to live in each and every one of you. God is the master who calls you. God is the potter who shapes you. As you say yes and yes and yes and yes, step out in faith, church, to be all that he has gifted and called you to be. Let's worship the Lord as we get our hearts ready for communion. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want you just to sit and listen as I sing this first song. It's entitled, "We Are His Hands," and it's an older song. I think it was done by Whiteheart. Anybody remember Whiteheart? Kind of dating ourselves there. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sweet Holy Spirit, come and have your way. How we need you, Jesus. Please be seated, just in an attitude of worship.
Oh, glory to God. Glory to the living God. Thank you, Pastor Cindy, for a wonderful message. Beautiful, beautiful worship service. I just don't know where to go. I don't know where to start. There's so much that I feel the Spirit of God wants to say this morning. Well, after that service, after that message, you realize that Pastor Cindy and I were far from perfect, but we love God, and we want to reflect Him every day, and we want to do a better job of that. And my friends, my family, I want you to know that there are people watching each and every one of you. And I told a young fellow that was here in church a little while ago that when I first got saved, I became a fruit inspector. I had watched people all my life that flew a flag that they were Christians, but when somebody rubbed them the wrong way, what fruit came out? Did it glorify God? Did it reflect the true nature of a living God that sent His only Son to die on the cross for us so that we could reflect His love? Is that what came out? Oftentimes not. We just don't know who's watching us. Before I came up, my daughter sent me a text from Arizona that she's watching this morning. Well, how many times in the community, in your family functions, in your family reunions and gathering, do you have family and friends that are watching you? We have no idea how our lives can impact somebody else. So much I want to say. I haven't always been perfect. I'm still not perfect. And when Pastor Cindy was sharing, you know, I realized that the pet peeve I have for my beautiful wife that triggers emotions on the inside that manifest, that don't reflect the love of the Father, the key word in that was it triggers me. If I'm crucified with Christ, then I should not have any flesh in me that should get triggered. So it's not her problem, it's mine. Church is a place where we should be surrounded by brothers and sisters in Christ who love God so much that they want to see the same thing reflected in you and in me. I want this church to be all that God has called it to be. So today, as we remember why we're having communion, I want us to remember that Jesus went to the cross and he bore all our infirmities. He bore all of our frailties so that we could be more of a reflection of that heavenly nature. So as we get ready to partake of communion this morning, just ask the Father for forgiveness if when you got squeezed, if fruit of the Spirit juice didn't come out of you, ask him for forgiveness now. Ask him to make you more like his son who was bruised and broken for all our iniquities. Let's partake together. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I have so much love pouring out of me right now. And I can just feel so much love coming back from you right now. Jesus, we just thank you that you made it possible for all these imperfect people to live together in perfect harmony, to reflect your nature, your relationship with the Father. And you showed us how much you love us when you hung on that cross and you bled and died that we may have all that heaven has to offer. So, Father, as we partake of this wine, we just thank you that you sealed this new covenant in your blood. There's no greater force in heaven and earth. There's no greater power than your blood. And we want to remember that, and we want to honor you right now with that memory. Oh, precious Lord, I thank you that your presence here today is tangible. And we just pray that every person that's been here and watching online today or will watch this message in the future will be able to feel and sense the anointing, the Holy Spirit hovering above his people, being here to touch hearts and change lives, not just for them, but for everybody they come in contact with. Father, I thank you for the diversity of your family called KCOG. I thank you, Father, that we celebrate our differences. We celebrate that each and every person is here to make a difference in this body, in this community, and in the world. So, Lord, I just release your family right now to go out those doors and be a total and utter nuisance to the devil in Jesus' name. Amen.
Everyone said amen, amen. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next week. Don't miss it. It's just going to get gooder and gooder. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.